Well, hi, New Paris folks. We're coming to you right now at 7:39 on Tuesday evening. Philip came to town and joined me, and we're going to have the layouts of our Love Feast and Communion. This probably is a first in this church. It's a first for myself of doing a video of communion. So we pray that we have a resource here that is different. So while everything is so different in the world and this service is different, we're going to have a different service that we follow too. So I pray that it'll still be meaningful to you. There'll be some questions that maybe you have asked, and we'll try to explain those. Scripture reading and prayer. So that way, it won't be a different service, but Philip nor I have communion or bread at this point. You should have that by now. Hopefully, it's somewhere around 4 o'clock on Sunday. And as you're doing this, you know there are other people that are doing this too. So what we are going to do here is right now, if we were at church, we would be saying at 4 o'clock, we'd be in the sanctuary and having a service of looking at our life and reflecting on our life and what's been going on. So that is at the point that we will pick it up. So there will be times when I tell you, you can pause the video and that you can have some discussion amongst yourselves. And of course, when it's time to eat or wash feet, you just stop it and then pick it up again. So, without further ado, we will start with the self-examination service.
Why is this night different from all other nights? Why is eating such a central part of our worship tonight? At other times of the evening worship, we eat a carrion meal before or after the service. And why are we so quiet as we eat?
Well, tonight we want to remember this afternoon that the meal that Jesus ate with his disciples on the night before his death. We celebrate the community created in Christ's life and his life events. Our silence and hushed whispers are in reverence for this powerful account and its meaning for our lives. In 1 Peter 2:10, we read, "Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy." Through Jesus' life, his death, and resurrection, he has created a new community of the saved. Through our spiritual baptism, we have passed from death to life and have become a part of that community.
Why do we take time to examine our hearts and confess our sins before we eat? Normally, we only offer a prayer to thank God for the food or sing a favorite table grace before the eating. Why do we need to take so much more time tonight?
Well, this meal that we share tonight is held in honor of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. It is a celebration of the gathered faith community. Even though we're not together, we are kindred mind and spirit, so we're together in that way. So we need to examine our hearts to make sure we are in a proper relationship with the Lord God and our brothers and sisters on this earth. If those relationships are broken, it's time to repair them. Our brother Paul warned us not to eat this meal in an unworthy manner. He said we would bring judgment upon ourselves if we did. And God's word talks about that in 1 Corinthians 11. It says, starting verse 27, "Therefore, whoever eats and drinks this cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and the blood of the Lord. A man ought to examine himself before he eats bread and drinks of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without recognizing the body of our Lord eats and drinks judgment on himself. That is why many of you are weak and sick, and a number of you have fallen asleep," which means they've died. "But if we judged ourselves, we would not come under judgment. When we are judged by the Lord, we are being disciplined so that we will not be condemned with the world." So our eating together is an act of worship. Jesus says that we might be in right relationship with one another. We should be in right relationship with one another before we offer our worship to God. In Matthew 5:23-24, this is taken up.
Therefore, if you are offering your gift at an altar, and there remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift there in front of the altar. First go and be reconciled to your brother, and then come and offer your gift.
God's reconciliation, and that means being brought together kind of as one, that becomes part of our life with others in the body of Christ. So we remember when Scripture says if we don't love Christ, we can't say we love, or if we don't love other people, we can't say that we love Christ. Now, longer ago, the elders and deacons of the church would visit each household in the weeks before the love feast. They would ask each member three questions. Are you still in faith of the gospel as you declared at your baptism? Are you, as far as you know, in peace and union with the church? Will you still labor with the brethren for an increase of holiness, both in yourselves and others? Now, we may no longer make these visits, but we take time to examine our lives and to confess so we can be reconciled to God and to each other. Then we can share this meal together as one body. Let us now examine ourselves and discover if there is something that would prevent us from eating together. If you are moved to share a confession with the community, please feel free to do so. Now we will take a moment for some silent meditation. Have mercy on me, O God. According to your steadfast love, according to your abundant mercy, blot.
Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity, and cleanly from my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me.
Create in me a clean heart, O God, and put a new and right spirit within me. Do not cast me away from your presence, and do not take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and sustain in me a willing spirit.
Then I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners will return to you. Deliver me from bloodshed, O God of my salvation, and my tongue will sing aloud of your deliverance.
O Lord, open my lips and mouth, that they will declare your praise. For you have no delight in sacrifice. If I were to give you a burnt offering, you would not be pleased.
The sacrifice acceptable to God is a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart. O God, you will not despise.
If we confess our sins, God is just and may be trusted to forgive our sins and to cleanse us from every kind of wrong. Let's pray. Lord, we are grateful for this opportunity to examine our lives. And Lord, it's not so much like we're trying to say, revisit sins and think that they're not forgiven. We know they are. But Lord, from time to time, it's good to see who we were before we came to you. And it's good to see that it was our sin that caused Christ so much pain on the cross. So Lord, just be with us as we continue with this service, as we continue praising you, bringing glory and honor to you. In Jesus' name. Now would be the time when we move to the basement. So just take a break if you need to. We'll be right back with you.
The presence of the Lord. and His grace.
I can hear the brush of angels' wings. I see glory on His face. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place.
We call this service the threefold love feast, but in a way, it's four parts. We've already done the self-examination. Now we're going to get ready for the feet washing service.
Why do we wash each other's feet before the meal? Before other meals, we wash only our hands, maybe our faces. Besides, I already had to wash before I came here. Aren't we clean enough? And why all the hugging and kissing afterward?
Well, the disciple Peter asked questions too. When Jesus bent down to wash his feet, he was right in assuming that washing feet was something to do with, has something to do with getting clean. Yet the main reason we wash each other's feet is that Jesus commanded us to do so. Let us listen to the story from Scripture of Jesus washing the disciples' feet. Perhaps that will help us understand.
It was just before the Passover feast. Jesus knew that the time had come for him to leave this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he now showed them the full extent of his love. The evening meal was being served, and the devil had already prompted Judas Iscariot, son of Simon, to betray Jesus. Jesus knew that the Father had put all things under his power, and that he had come from God and was returning to God. So he got up from the meal, took off his outer clothing, and wrapped a towel around his waist. After that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash his disciples' feet, drying them with a towel that was wrapped around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus replied, "You do not realize now what I am doing, but later you will understand." "No," said Peter, "you shall never wash my feet." Jesus answered, "Unless I wash you, you have no part with me." "Then, Lord," Simon Peter replied, "not just my feet, but my hands and my head as well." Jesus answered, "A person who has had a bath needs only to wash his feet. His whole body is clean. And you are clean, though not every one of you." For he knew who was going to betray him, and that is why he said not everyone was clean. When he had finished washing their feet, he put on his clothes and returned to his place. "Do you understand what I have done for you?" he asked them. You call me teacher and Lord, and rightly so, for that is what I am. Now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you should also wash one another's feet. I have set you an example that you should do as I have done for you. I tell you the truth, no servant is greater than his master, nor is a messenger greater than the one who sent him. Now that you know these things, you will be blessed if you do them.
There is a cleansing element in feet washing that in some ways is kind of related to the cleansing that we receive at baptism. In feet washing, we are symbolically washing our feet of sins without having to be baptized again and again. Most of us washed our feet before we came tonight, yet I need you to wash my feet, and I need you to help me in my Christian walk. We need each other. I also need to wash your feet. Jesus, through his example and commandment, teaches us to serve one another as humble servants. In Jesus' day, washing feet was an act of hospitality performed by a servant. After a long journey traveling on dusty roads in sandaled feet, washing feet was a welcome act of kindness. It was unheard of for a rabbi of Jesus' stature to bend down and wash his disciples' feet. Through this act, Jesus taught that we are all brothers and sisters in his community and that leaders are servants of all. And as Christians, we need not only to serve each other, but we also need to wash the feet of the poor and homeless of the world. Why do we kiss and hug? To show our affection to one another. We often call this the holy kiss. In several of his letters, Paul tells us to kiss one another in greeting or when they depart. Let us now participate in the ordinance of feet washing. Take this opportunity to pause your video and wash the feet of your families, maybe your spouse, maybe your child. May you indeed enjoy this special, special privilege. After the feet washing comes the meal of fellowship.
Why do we eat such simple food at this meal? Why don't we have more food and more variety? We don't even get dessert.
Our fellowship meal tonight is largely symbolic. Eating together is one of the most common human experiences. When we eat together, we nourish our physical bodies and we also nurture our relationships. We remember especially the last meal that Jesus shared with his disciples. We remember that the early church shared more than just food. Some of them held all things in common. We also look forward to the end of time when we will share this meal with Christ and a cloud of witnesses from all the ages. Then there will be no hunger, no pain, no death, and Christ shall wipe the tears from our eyes. Even strangers and sojourners will be welcome at this great banquet. This afternoon, as we eat a simple meal, keep your mind on these things rather than on the food itself. We eat this meal this afternoon to share with each other in love and fellowship. On the night of the last meal, Jesus gave us the commandment to love one another. We find this written in John's Gospel.
As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Now remain in my love. If you obey my commands, you will remain in my love, just as I have obeyed my Father's commands and remain in his love. I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. My command is this: love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, that he lay down his life for his friends. You are my friends if you do what I command. I no longer call you servants because a servant does not know his master's business. Instead, I have called you friends, for everything I have learned from my Father, I have made known unto you. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you to go and bear fruit. Fruit that will last. Then the Father will give you whatever you ask in my name. This is my command. Love each other.
Let's pray. Lord, there are probably all kinds of meals being had, from maybe very simple to maybe just a little more elaborate. That's not the point, Lord. May we share together as families. May we share with one another as we eat this meal. All the time reflecting on the time when Jesus introduced his betrayer at this meal, and of how this night's events, the Last Supper night's events, would proceed for him. So, Lord, may this food be used to strengthen our body for your use, we pray. Amen. You may now eat your meal.
Break bread together on our knees.
now we come to the fourth part of our service, the eating and sharing of the bread and the cup.
So why do we eat this strange bread and drink these little glasses of grape juice? We've already eaten a symbolic meal together.
Yes, we have eaten together. But now we remember a special part of that Last Supper Jesus shared with his disciples. We remember that Jesus blessed and broke bread and blessed the cup and shared it that night. It is likely that Jesus broke unleavened bread without yeast that makes it rise. This bread went back to the earlier ages of Israel when they came out of Egypt on a night long time ago. The bread and cup remind us of Christ's liberating action, and it came through his suffering and death on a cross. This he did for our salvation. The prophet Isaiah describes the work of Christ as in his words. He says it this way. Who has believed our report? And who has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up before him like a tender shoot and like a root out of dry ground. He had no beauty or majesty to attract us to him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and familiar with suffering. Like one from whom men hide their faces, he was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he took up our infirmities and carried our sorrows. Yet we considered him stricken by God, smitten by him, and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him, and by his wounds we are healed. We all like sheep have gone astray. Each of us has turned to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. He was led like a lamb to slaughter, and as a sheep before her shears is silent, so he did not open his mouth. By oppression and judgment he was taken away. And who can speak of his descendants? For he was cut off from the land of the living. For the transgression of my people he was stricken. He was assigned a grave with the wicked, and with the rich in his death, though he had not done any violence. Nor was any deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the Lord's will to crush him and cause him to suffer. And though the Lord makes his life a guilt offering, he will see his offspring and prolong his days. And the will of the Lord will prosper in his hand. We have heard Christ's call to remembrance. Now I invite you to share the bread and the cup. All who are in love and community with your brothers and sisters, who do truly and earnestly turn away from your sins, who humbly put your trust in Christ and desire his help that you may lead a holy life, draw near to God and receive these sacred emblems to your comfort through Jesus Christ, our Lord. You may pick up your bread and cup. Well, just bread for now. Jesus took bread and broke it, saying, "This is my body given for you." Let's pray. Lord, there's no argument that your body was the most precious body of anyone who ever lived. And by that, I don't necessarily mean physical enamorment, but for what you did for us, for taking on our sins. And Lord, we break the bread, remembering that your body was broken. As scripture said, not a bone would be broken, and that was true. But you had nail holes in your wrist. You had nail holes in your ankles. You had a place in your side where the sword was stuck. And Lord, we ask for forgiveness for our sins because we realize, Lord, you were there for us. We were supposed to be there. So as we eat this bread, Lord, may we humbly remember that day and that afternoon when you suffered so badly for us. In Jesus' name, amen. You may eat the bread.
Jesus took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood." Let's pray. Loving Lord, we thank you for the grapes that have been gathered and crushed to make this juice. Bring us together in the unity of your Spirit. We remember the blood you shed for us and thank you for the new covenant it is sealed between us and God. Bless this cup we drink in your name. Amen.
Let us speak these words together. The cup which we bless is the communion of the blood of Christ. We want to thank you for taking time out of your busy afternoon to have a love feast like none other. It came to me as we were doing this that I invited and thanked those from New Paris for being here, but perhaps someone else will come across this video and see one of the two most holy times, I think, that we get to serve God all year. So we pray that you have a good rest of your day. As I was studying this week, I found that there are things that were really different between the Passover and the Last Supper, which we shouldn't be surprised at. But this one surprised me, that the guests for Passover would stay through the night and go home in the morning. But we know the scripture says that the disciples sang a song and went out into the night. So as you hear or sing along with this song, this will be the conclusion of this love feast of 2020. Lord, we thank you, and we just praise you for all you have done, for who you are. Lord, thank you for the opportunity to share, to worship, and may all of this bring glory and honor to Jesus' name. Amen.
My master went, clean for spent, for spent. Into the woods my master came, for spent with love and shame. But the olives, they were not blind to him. The little green leaves were kind to him. The thorn tree had
my master came content with death.